The following audio is via a Skype call.
Welcome to Lucid Planet Radio with Dr. Kelly Neff. This hit show will illuminate your senses and empower you beyond your daily stressors and hardships. Renowned psychologist and author Dr. Kelly will captivate you with far-reaching topics and amazing guests as you wake to the greatest version of yourself. Learn to tap into your intuitions, think critically about our world, heal emotional and psychological wounds, and follow your passions to live your dreams. You'll learn how to navigate the global shift of consciousness and explore the deeper knowledge within. Welcome home. Now here's your host, Dr. Kelly Neff.
Hello, everyone. I am Dr. Kelly Neff, and you are listening to Lucid Planet Radio here on Transformation Talk Radio. Stay with us and let us help you experience healing, knowledge, and inspiration this week. We have some really great gifted scientists, healers, speakers, and authors on this show, helping you to become the greatest version of yourself. And today is no exception. And remember, you can find out more by visiting thelucidplanet.com and iTunes, SoundCloud, TuneIn Radio, all that good stuff. You can hear our archive shows and also find me on Instagram to kind of get a taste of my weird and wonderful life. Now, as many as you know, the midterm elections are coming up and it is lit. People across the political spectrum are getting very passionate about this. Now, as you also know from listening, hopefully, to over 100 episodes of the show, I don't really talk a lot about politics or focus on it. And it's not because I am like an apathetic person or I don't like dialogue. It's because lately things have been so intense, people fighting each other, arguing online every time you turn on the TV, and ain't nobody got time for that. But one thing we do know about psychology is that once people have a strong attitude, like in the field of persuasion research, they are they're unlikely to listen when you try to change their minds. So when you're talking about deeply held beliefs, this is why I think there's so much arguing and why I kind of try to stay out of it. But having said that, there are some issues in the spectrum that are incredibly important to me. And as you know from listening to my past shows, one of those is drug policy reform, specifically increasing access to and ending prohibition towards cannabis. Now, yes, I live in Colorado, first state in the union to legalize recreational marijuana. We've had it for many years. It's very easy to take these freedoms for granted. Legalization in Colorado, of course, has led to huge tax revenues for education and state programs, reduced the amount of people using opioids, and afforded lots of opportunities to many people. But there is still a struggle happening. Many people in the U.S. and certainly across the world are facing the struggle for a plant. Now, the reason I think this topic is important right now is because whether you are a Republican, a Democrat, a libertarian, a socialist, whatever, you can probably agree that it is rather ludicrous that the most FDA-researched plant in history, with empirically and practically proven health benefits out the wazoo, is still federally Schedule 1 in 2018, meaning that it is no deemed acceptable medical use. I believe that, particularly for my generation of millennials, that in these times of fighting and division, support for access to this plant is something that the majority of millennials can get behind. And in fact, more Americans now than ever believe that that marijuana should be regulated and legalized, really regardless as to their political affiliation. So there are changes happening. They need to happen on a congressional level, a state level, and a federal level as far as scheduling. But there are also states' rights issues, meaning who you elect as your state representatives can have a big impact on your access to cannabis, not to mention the ballot measures pending in every state. So today I have an expert here to unravel all of these concepts, and I'm absolutely thrilled to welcome Justin Strekal, who is the political director of NORML, which is, of course, the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. He lives and breathes this stuff. He's in D.C. He is coming at us with the rundown on everything you need to know on the marijuana midterms. So let's please welcome Justin to the show. Hey, Justin.
Hey, Kelly. Thank you so very much for having me, and really great to be here.
Wonderful to have you here. Now, you're a lobbyist in D.C., correct?
I am. I commonly refer to myself as a scumbag lobbyist, with a little bit of self-deprecation, just because the practice of lobbying in general is a pretty corrupt institution. But that isn't to say that there aren't people who are doing terrific work. We're just often outnumbered and outspent. But yeah, no, I live and breathe Washington D.C. politics and the policies going on, overseeing 50 state legislatures, working with our local chapters around the country to help craft sound, data-driven public policy solutions to ending cannabis criminalization.
Awesome. How did you get into this line of work?
I fell backwards into it accidentally. I fancy myself a policy wonk and a political hack, and I was working on a campaign, managing a congressional in Virginia, when for a state senator who had introduced a decriminalization bill in the past as a state senator of the Virginia State Senate, and NORML had reached out to the campaign, and we were talking and ended up endorsing the campaign. While we were unsuccessful in that bid for Congress, I went with the state senator to work in the Capitol and ended up running the politics for the decriminalization effort there in Virginia. And this was in 2015, and unfortunately we fell a little short and we were unable to move the bill forward. We did make some substantial reforms regarding marijuana policy in the Commonwealth, by ending the practice of automatically suspending an individual's driver's license for 6 months for a simple mere possession charge.
Wow.
Because that currently, you know, Virginia was the, there were 11 states left that were doing that. Now that Virginia has moved away from that policy, there are still 10 states in this country where you get caught with a joint and you get processed and you get that arrest, you automatically will lose your driver's license for 6 months. Which is an absolutely heinous policy response to a victimless crime.
It is. It's kind of draconian.
I was really proud of what we accomplished in Virginia. And a couple of years later, NORML reached out and wanted to inquire as whether or not I would be available to come and help with federal policy work. And I've been here for 2 years now. And, you know, I have to say it is probably the most exciting time ever to be working on this policy, because there is so much momentum moving forward. But unfortunately, in 28 states in this country, you can still go to jail for simply possessing marijuana. And the collateral consequences follow people for the rest of their life. And you know, we need substantial reforms at state, local, and the federal level.
Absolutely. I could not agree with you more for a victimless crime with a healing plant. I would love to know your take on this as we're heading into what you were calling the marijuana midterms. What is the political landscape right now on the federal level?
The landscape at the federal level has never been more supportive. As of this moment, last week, we had the 42nd co-sponsor sign on to legislation known as the Marijuana Justice Act, which would not only remove cannabis from the Controlled Substances Act entirely, so that way it would leave it up to the states as to how they regulate and implement their own policies, similar to alcohol or tobacco, but it would actually create a disincentive for states to maintain criminalization. It would do is one of the things that it's, you know, one of the nuances of the policy when we talk about our federal structure is, even if we remove cannabis from the Controlled Substances Act tomorrow, there will still, for years to come, be tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of arrests made every year. Because most of the laws where people are getting arrested under are state and local policies. That's why we need people on the ground making sure that they're affecting change in their local communities, where their voices are much more powerful. But if we ended federal prohibition tomorrow, there will still be many states that maintain criminalization for years to come. But what the Marijuana Justice Act would do is it says that if those states that maintain criminalization in a disproportional fashion use that criminalization against marginalized communities in a disproportionate way, the federal government would restrict funding for prison construction and for additional law enforcement construction to that statewide rate of 10%. And then not only would they restrict that state's federal funding for prison and new law enforcement construction funds, they would direct that funding that they're restricting into housing and urban development for targeted projects in communities that have been most affected by the war on drugs.
Wow.
So it's the most robust reparative justice bill that we've ever seen introduced in Congress when it comes to cannabis policy. And as of today, as of this moment, there are 43 members of Congress on that bill. A full 10% of the Congress has put their name as a co-sponsor on that legislation to move it forward.
That's amazing.
It's only members of the party that is not currently in power.
which might change.
But bipartisan efforts are moving forward, too. And there is a bill that would simply remove marijuana from the CSA, and that's up to 40 members of Congress on it, and that's a bipartisan bill. So we're moving forward, and more lawmakers are looking for ways to evolve their positions, to see the light, if you will.
Criminalization. So, I mean, what it sounds like is we're moving into a phase, I'm very excited about it, that there's more momentum than ever before, but people still need to step up and contact their representatives, be active in their communities, vote, all that good stuff. And we're going to take a quick break, but when we come back, Justin is going to share with us how to get more involved and how to use NORML's resources to get more involved. And then we're going to break it down in terms of what's going on in the individual states that have hotly contested races and ballot measures. So stay tuned. We'll be right back on Lucid Planet Radio talking much more about the marijuana midterms.
Tune in to Lucid Planet Radio with Dr. Kelly Neff. This hit show will illuminate your senses and empower you beyond your daily stressors and hardships. Renowned psychologist and author Dr. Kelly will captivate you with far-reaching topics and amazing guests as you wake to the greatest version of yourself. Learn to tap into your intuitions, think critically about our world, heal emotional and psychological wounds, and follow your passions to live your dreams. The Lucid Planet. Welcome home. Visit lucidplanetradio.com for more information.
Tune in to E3 Influence Radio. Own your impact. Master your world. In this new hit show, Sarah Luce, empowerment coach and spiritual mentor, teaches us how to achieve our greatest potential to positively affect everything and everyone. The time is now to enlighten our minds, empower our hearts, and take energized action to raise the consciousness of our planet. Sarah shows us how with simple, easy-to-implement steps. To find out more about Sarah Luce and her E3 Influence program, visit saraluce.com.
Do you believe you are meant to live with more joy, but you're just not sure how to get it? What does the phrase, give me the joy, make you feel? Join me, Lynn Horde, every second and fourth Thursday, 9 a.m. Pacific, 12 p.m. Eastern, on the Give Me the Joy Show, as I take you on a journey to peel back the layers so you can take back your joy. To find out more about my work as the Joy Coach, including my popular programs, Joy School and Joy at Work, visit lynnhorde.com.
Are you done being afraid to jump into the life that's waiting for you? Are you ready for a real shift? I invite you to tune in every Tuesday with me, Tracy L, on the Tracy L Clark Show, where we will teach you how to live your extraordinary life. At 8 a.m. Pacific on Transformation Talk Radio, where I will provide the tools and the steps needed to help you transcend perceived limitations and move forward with an extraordinary life. For more information, visit me at tracylclark.com.
To see your life from an angel's perspective, book a personal consultation with Claire Candy Huff. Angelic walk-in angel Ariel at Angel Healing House. Candy provides intuitive counseling, Reiki, and angel readings in person in Los Angeles or nationally and internationally via phone or Skype. She will channel the practical tools you need to transform your life. Call now, 831-277-3716 or visit angelhealinghouse.com.
If you're dealing with fear and anxiety, you've probably noticed that the more you fight these emotions, the stronger they seem to get. Dr. Friedemann Schaub, the author of The Fear and Anxiety Solution, explains that instead of suppressing, we need to identify and resolve the deeper, subconscious root causes of fear and anxiety. His personal breakthrough program has helped thousands worldwide to overcome their emotional challenges. To learn more, visit thefearandanxietysolution.com and schedule your free consultation with Dr. Schaub now.
Got to get back. I need some get back. Payback.
Yes. Oh, sorry. I could just listen to that song all day. but we're back here on Lucid Radio with Dr. Kelly. And my guest today is Justin Strekal, who is talking with us about cannabis policy reform. Justin, before we continue, I want to make sure that everyone knows how to contact you to find out more about getting involved with NORML and all the great resources you guys have.
Certainly. Well, easiest way to get involved or find out how to get involved is at our website, www.normal.org. We're so normal, we left out the A. and there you can find links where you can send pre-written letters or you can edit them as you see fit, in support of pending legislation at the federal level and at the state level, where state legislatures are still open, as well as find out about our chapter structure. We have over 150 chapters around the country. If there isn't a local chapter in your area, it's really easy to start one. We do a lot to empower people and to build local leadership with regular leadership calls and trainings and conferences and other things, because we need boots on the ground. Because your voice in your city council hall or your state legislature is going to go further than any paid efforts of advertisements or whatever could possibly go. So we need you involved, NORML.org.
Perfect. And we were talking during the break about the Marijuana Justice Act, which Justin just discussed with us, which is, you know, the best reparative justice bill we've ever seen when it comes to cannabis. And I was asking him during the break, well, when are they voting? And he said, well, they're not voting until, you know, Congress potentially switches. So can you just elaborate on that a little bit? Like, for people in California, they already have legalization, so they don't care. But still, who they vote into Congress matters on the federal level.
Correct. And you bring up California. In California, Senator Feinstein is the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee in the Capitol. And that is an incredibly powerful position. But in her role as the minority leader, as the ranking member and not the chairwoman, she's unable to call for a vote. She can request a vote, but she cannot make the committee vote on it. And Senator Feinstein actually recently co-sponsored legislation that would prevent federal intervention into state legal programs known as the States Act, which is being carried by Senator Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts.
Mm-hmm.
But, what we need, the last vestiges preventing us from moving reform forward is not lack of support. As of right now, as of today, we have the votes in both chambers of Congress to end prohibition. What we do not have is the support of the gatekeepers of both chambers' judiciary committees, as well as the chairman of the Rules Committee in the House of Representatives, nor the speaker or majority leader. These five individuals are able to stall nearly any type of criminal justice reform policy whatsoever. And none of them have lifted one finger to advance any type of legislation that would end the status quo of criminalization. And they have been fighting us for years.
Mm-hmm. And so if the balance of Congress were to switch, which it might do, then that there would be different people.
It is looking likely. Yeah, it is looking likely in the House. And right now in the House Judiciary Committee, the ranking member is a member of Congress from New York named Jerry Nadler. And Mr. Nadler has actually been a co-sponsor of a descheduling bill in the previous Congress. And he is very supportive of our efforts. And we suspect, should he become the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, or, you know, Democrats take control and another member of the Judiciary Committee assume the gavel, it's likely that we'd be able to move forward, at least in the House of Representatives.
Which would be amazing progress, and to actually get to see a vote on this topic. And, you know, this is just going back to the point, like, if you care about this, then you can vote for your local representatives. And I know that there's a lot of hotly contested Senate and House races in the midterm elections, that some of these people are very pro-cannabis reform and some of them are very anti-cannabis reform. I know Texas has one. Are there some other states where there are some pretty hotly contested races right now, Justin?
Yeah. The two best examples of differing approaches to marijuana policy in the Senate races playing out right now are in Texas and in, or, well, there are three, Texas, Arizona, and Nevada. Right now in Texas, our NORML PAC, not the organization I work for, but our the Political Action Committee, they've endorsed Congressman Beto O'Rourke. Beto O'Rourke is a champion of marijuana reform policy. He is on every bill that we've asked him to be on. He has introduced legislation that would address what I mentioned earlier regarding the license suspension of those arrested for mere possession. And he's talking about it. He's driving around Texas on a regular basis every day when he's given his stump speech. And he's talking about what he views as some of the most important issues right now facing voters. He is talking about marijuana policy. He's talking about the disproportionate arrest rates that are falling on minority communities and on poor communities. He's talking about the collateral effects of that arrest record, how it makes it harder for people to get a job, it makes it harder for them to find housing, get access to higher education, get access to health care. You know, a laundry list of things that having that criminal record makes it harder for you to be a good, productive citizen in our nation when you're an otherwise completely law-abiding citizen. So he's talking about it. We're a big supporter of Beto O'Rourke. Other races, Arizona, Congresswoman Sinema, Kirsten Sinema is running for the seat being vacated by Jeff Flake. Jeff Flake is a co-sponsor on comprehensive reform legislation. He's one of the few Republicans to do so. But he's not running for re-election. And in that race, there's a clear choice. You know, Kirsten Sinema will vote the way we want her to, and it's unlikely that Martha McSally, the Republican congresswoman running for that seat, would. And then similarly in Nevada, where Congresswoman Jackie Rosen is running, the congresswoman and NORML have a fun relationship on Twitter. We tweet each other sometimes. She's a co-sponsor on the Marijuana Justice Act. She's a great advocate for the residents of Nevada, in terms of the fact that they just recently legalized marijuana and their system has been running efficiently.
Yes.
And she would be a good vote, and she would vote the right way and champion our issue, whereas Senator Heller, the Republican incumbent, has refused to utter his support for pending reform efforts that would protect his constituents and the emerging industry in his state. So there's a clear choice in those three states where they're all very close races, so all of your listeners who care about cannabis reform policy and either live in those three, Nevada, Arizona, or Texas, or know people who do, or know people who know people who do, now's the time to make sure that they're getting involved, that they're getting informed. Which brings me to vote.normal.org.
Yes.
We recently released our scorecard. It's the most comprehensive database of candidates' positions on marijuana policy ever created. We have thousands and thousands of candidates registered. It's a wiki-style system, so if we're missing someone who's running for state office, users can submit that information. We'll review it. We need sources for everything, but yes, we'll get it up there. And you know, you can view that. Either go to normal.org, go to it, or vote.normal.org.
Awesome resource. I've been checking it out all morning. Really cool. And yeah, so when it comes to this stuff, your vote definitely does matter out there, guys. You know, Texas is probably the most interesting to me because it's a massive state. And everyone always says that, like, once Texas legalizes cannabis, then the whole rest of the country is going to. Do you agree with that?
I don't know. Right now, North Dakota has a ballot initiative to legalize marijuana in 2018.
I think given
how North Dakota has, you know, a bit more of a conservative bend than Texas does, I think that would be a more significant canary in the coal mine, if you will.
Yeah, that's fascinating.
As a view that it's time for both parties to get on board.
What's the support like in North Dakota? What do you know the name of the, or what's the initiative too for people who are going to the polls?
Absolutely. In North Dakota, it's Measure 3. And I actually just spent almost a week in North Dakota a couple weeks ago. And the support there is pretty strong. At the top of our conversation when you were introducing me, you mentioned it doesn't matter who you are, Democrat, Republican, Libertarian, Socialist, or undecided, you know, or indecisive. Whatever your political ideology is, there is a way to, consistent with your core political principles, come to the conclusion that cannabis criminalization is wrong. It is 100% wrong for people who consume to live under the threat of going to jail. It is wrong for those who don't consume, but know, have loved ones, friends, family members, neighbors, colleagues, constantly living under that threat. And, you know, you can do it from a liberal perspective or a conservative perspective or just simply an apathetic perspective. And you need to vote for it, because the only way that policies change is when people force their politicians to do so. And politicians will only take action when they are concerned that inaction will cause them to lose their job.
Amen to that. I think about Colorado. I mean, it was a state ballot initiative that got us the first legal recreational weed, you know, and it's because everybody turned up for it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Absolutely. And you know, it's a thing increasingly popular with, you know, with our fellow countrymen. Most recent polling had 68% support in favor of outright legalization. And when it comes to medical, 94% of Americans support medical.
I think the more that people get access to the medicine and they use it as medicine, they start to realize that they've been lied to and programmed and brainwashed to think it's like this horrible demonic substance. And like, for, especially for the older generation, like the grandmas out there, you know, using it for their fibromyalgia. we have to take a quick break right now.
Yeah,
fibromyalgia. But we're going to take a quick break. We're going to get more into this in just a few minutes. So stick with us here on Lucid Planet Radio. Justin Strekal and I will be talking more about the marijuana midterms, ballot measures, and some other interesting law changes and pending things that are happening. So stick with us. We'll be right back.
Demystifying the journey on From Here to There Radio with your host, Diane Garris. Tune in every third Wednesday, 4 p.m. Pacific Time on TransformationTalkRadio.com as Diane helps you get from where you are now to the life you envision. Get ready to get unstuck and move forward. Every show features a new special segment, New Age Notes, demystifying hot metaphysical topics of the day. For more information or to work with Diane, visit DianeGarris.com.
Practice living in wholeness with the body tune-up. 6 classes for $89 designed for radical self-healing and self-regeneration. Heal the deepest root of any challenge. The mental body was programmed in negativity, not good enough. Separate from source, you're too much, you'll never make it. The emotional body holds all the pain and trauma of emotional suppression. All the pain from this life and life's past. The spiritual body is the place you connect with your higher power, your higher self, with the image and likeness of the One. The physical body houses and expresses the other three bodies every day. Go to CorneliaStephanie.com. Evolve, become a practitioner. We need to heal, integrate, and bring into wholeness and harmony the physical body, addressing all the other bodies in order to live in our true, authentic nature.
Dream on, fly high, and live adventurously on The Laura Meeks Show. Tune in each month on Transformation Talk Radio as host Laura Meeks guides you in finding your unique gifts and bringing them to life. As a certified life coach, speaker, and veteran bomber pilot for the U.S. Air Force, Laura knows how to follow a dream. She is ready to support you so you can dream on, fly high, and live adventurously. For more information on Laura and her work, visit flyhighliving.com.
Stay juicy. Tune in to Your Juicy Love with me, Una Drake, co-hosting monthly with Dr. Pat, and every second Monday at 12 p.m. on Transformation Talk Radio. My show, Your Juicy Love, helps you find the dynamic, life-affirming love you've always wanted. Transform your relationships and bring peace, joy, and juicy, juicy love to planet Earth. For more information, visit unadrake.com.
Have you been searching for a push to step out and share your gifts with the world? Allow Charlene Hess to empower you to start shedding the layers of your ego that are holding you back and begin feeling connected to your heart so that you can shine your unique divine light and share your gifts with the world. Tune in to The Charlene Hess Show, Living on Your Heart's Edge, every third Friday at noon Pacific on TransformationTalkRadio.com. For more information, visit CharleneHess.com.
We are back on Lucid Planet Radio with Dr. Kelly, and I have NORML's political director, Justin Strekal, on the show today, talking with us about cannabis policy reform in the context of the upcoming midterm elections. All right, Justin. So we talked a little bit about North Dakota. Would you like to share with us some of the other ballot measures that are happening? Are people in their states are actually going to get to turn out to the polls and decide if they want medical and or recreational cannabis to be legal in their state?
Absolutely. Well, this year we have four states where voters are going to be going to the polls in November. And earlier this year, we had a fifth state, Oklahoma, in June, voted to approve medical marijuana in that state. So we're in 2018, we already had a significant victory of Oklahoma becoming the 31st state to be a medical marijuana state.
Woo-woo!
We already hit, I know. So now 62 senators in the U.S. Senate represent states that have a medical marijuana program, either enacted or in the process. We already touched on Measure 3 in North Dakota. That one's going to be a street fight. So any of your listeners in North Dakota, know people in North Dakota, or know people who know people in North Dakota, you got to tell them that they got to vote for Measure 3, because that one's going to be close. In Michigan, another full legalization campaign. This is Prop 1. What this would do is it would, in a very similar matter to the other states that have already legalized and set up regulated systems for the cultivation and distribution of marijuana, as well as a reasonable tax that would be directed to infrastructure programs and education in the mitten state. So Michigan is Prop 1. It's very exciting. Polling looks good, but it's not so good that we feel comfortable about it. It's consistently been in the high 50s. Michigan, another state, critical. Anyone you know in Michigan needs to be aware and to turn out to vote for Prop 1.
All right,
when
Michigan,
it comes to the medical
turn
side,
up.
Oh, wait, sorry. What on Michigan?
Oh, I was just going to ask, is this a majority? Do they need more? Like, remember how Florida had that prop? Was it Prop 2? It had to be over 60? It has to be at 60?
Yeah, no, all of these, fortunately, are just outright majority states. So 50
okay.
Plus one.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Thanks for clarifying that for me.
Oh, no, absolutely. And that's a really astute point, because I know in Florida they're getting ready. There's a lot of efforts underway to get a legalization bill or a ballot initiative going there. And that 60% threshold is a high bar.
It's tough.
But also this year, come November 6th, voters in Utah, Colorado's neighbor, will have the opportunity to go to the ballot box and vote for a medical marijuana program in Utah. Unfortunately, in Utah, while polling looks, again, another area where it's promising, but we don't feel overly confident, polling in the high 50s, but in recent days, a couple big money people in Utah have ponied up significant amounts to spend to run an anti-medical marijuana campaign. And also the Church of Latter-day Saints has come out against medical marijuana.
I was going to ask you about that. If it's a religious opposition, it is.
Yeah, there is, but the opposition from the church hasn't been quite as fervent as some of us expected it possibly could be. But with less than 5 weeks to election day, there's still a lot of time for them to choose to do more. But there have been a couple, you know, really wealthy individuals who are dropping, you know, six-figure contributions to the no campaign. So Utah, another street fight. Make sure anyone you know who's in Utah.
What number is the ballot measure in Utah?
Oh, that is a good. Oh, you're asking me things that I. So many.
We can look
Utah
it up.
Utah is. Oh no, I got it. Utah. I want to say it's two. Proposition two. Proposition two in Utah, medical marijuana.
Cool.
And then in Missouri. Missouri is our fourth state, and there's something that we've never seen before going on in Missouri, and that's there are three different opportunities for people to vote for a medical marijuana program in the Show Me state.
Really?
So it's really interesting. Two of them are constitutional amendments, and one of them is merely a statutory proposition. So our lawyers are telling us, whichever constitutional amendment gets the most votes is going to be the one that goes into effect. And then if neither of the constitutional amendments pass, but the proposition passes, then the proposition will become the law. But the constitutional amendments would trump, either one of them would trump the statutory proposition. We're supportive of Amendment 2. And they're all medical. I've confirmed with my legal counsel, three medical initiatives doesn't turn it into a magical one legalization bill. I was really hoping it would be a hat trick effect, but unfortunately that's not the case. So in Missouri, the best one is Amendment 2. And what that would do, it would create a medical program, create a portion of the tax revenue generated from the industry side of things would go to veterans health care in the state, and it has the lowest tax rate of all three of the initiatives, so it's the most pro-patient, and it provides other important legal protections like the legal right for limited home cultivation of your medicine, because unfortunately in some states they don't include limited lawful home cultivation. Law enforcement, merely predicated on the odor of marijuana at your front door, could say that they have reasonable suspicion as a result of the odor that you're growing marijuana, and they could enter your home. Whereas if you even if that plant number is only two, you're only legally allowed to grow two plants, then that takes away the compelling state interest for law enforcement to be able to enter your home on the suspicion of cultivation.
That's what Colorado, I think, allows six per household.
12.
I think. 12 is 12?
It used to be 99.
Yeah, California
used to be 99.
And then
they scaled it back.
Yeah. And that's a whole other thing about what's happening in these states where there has been new legalization. The way that it's gone into effect, the way it's affected people. People who were using that plant crowd for the medical dispensary system. I know in California, that system's now non-existent. And so a lot of those people can't continue to cultivate for their collectives anymore in California. There's all these gray areas in the law. And then with regards to federal funding for the search and seizure for cannabis, even in these legal states. I know California, can you speak to that at all? I know California, there was a thing going on where the government was still getting money, or the federal government was still giving money to the police to do raids. Do you know anything about that?
Yeah. So there is still, the bulk of that is to go into national parks because there are illegal grow sites in national parks.
I see.
So the bulk of that attention is and funding is going to that. There have been a few for unlicensed dispensaries that are currently operating. But again, we're talking about sites that are not in, that are advertising as if they're a licensed retail business that are not.
Oh, okay. I see.
So
thank you for clarifying that. I had some questions about that. So we've had a lot of interesting listener questions. We have to take a quick break in a couple of minutes, but I just wanted to ask you really quickly, who are the types of people that donate $500,000 or $1 million to an anti-marijuana legalization campaign? Like you gave the example of Utah. What do they have interests that go against it, or is it just like a religious thing? Or do you have any kind of insight on the psychology of that?
Yeah, I would largely categorize them as awful people. when we're talking about individuals of wealth and privilege who are willing to spend sizable amounts of money to deny people who are suffering from illnesses access to a therapeutic substance that would alleviate their suffering. You're a heinous human being.
When you say it like that, it really doesn't sound good.
No. People buy into prohibition and the status quo of criminalization for a lot of different reasons. None of them are rooted in data or reality.
Yep. Okay.
Delusional,
agree.
I suppose, is the easiest delusional. Way to categorize delusional,
psychological,
powerful, rich people.
Yeah. Well, you know, and hopefully they're wasting their money and these things pass anyway. You know, that's the good thought. So, guys, we're going to take a break, but just remember ballot initiatives, Michigan, Prop 1, Missouri, Amendment 2, North Dakota, Measure 3, and Utah, Prop 2. And you can find out all of this and more just by going to vote.normal.org. You can see all the endorsed candidates for every race. If this is an issue that you care about, which it probably is if you're still listening to the show, check it out. And on that note, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about Canada. So stick with us, and we'll be back on Lucid Planet Radio here in a couple minutes.
Come here, baby. America, love. Do it, baby.
Did you know that all of the shows on the Transformation Radio Network are available as podcasts to stream or download?
Really?
Check us out. Go to transformationradio.fm. We have business shows, spiritual shows, energy healing shows, and pretty much everything in between. Something for everyone guaranteed to inspire, educate, and transform. We are transforming the world, one listener at a time.
What is a brilliant culture, and how do we create them? Why are they important? Claudette Rowley has created a breakthrough five-step process to help you align your culture with your business strategy for exceptional results. Looking for a culture that drives organizational excellence? Listen to Cultural Brilliance Radio, the second and fourth Friday of each month at 10 a.m. Pacific and 1 p.m. Eastern on Transformation Talk Radio. To learn more or work with Claudette, visit culturalbrilliance.com.
Relationships are bridges. Truly, they are bridges. Think about it. We're all here for our journey. And relationships help us fulfill ourselves, find ourselves, and get to the highest potential. So as you need, as you fulfill your dreams, you also give people space to fulfill their dreams. So remember integrity, respectfulness, and nice, deep love and soft touch is essential for every relationship. So what are we not going to do? We are not going to possess. We are not going to be overly attached and be a tag on. And we will not unnecessarily get involved or control others. Because when we do so, we lose ourselves, we lose our path. So let us live with love, respect, and some beautiful dignity.
Would you like your next chapter to be free from fear and angst? Tune in to Your Next Chapter Radio, navigating through life's transitions with Shelley Ryan, the fourth Monday at 12 p.m. Pacific on TransformationTalkRadio.com. Shelley's contagious enthusiasm guides you through life's transitions deliberately, mindfully, and funnily. For Your Next Chapter coaching or to listen, visit YourNextChapterCoaching.com or call 602-617-8351. Next!
Calling all ladies. Are you struggling with neck, back, shoulder pain, or postural issues? You actually might have a related bra problem. Talk to Maria Monti at the Healthy Bra Company. She is a professional postural therapist who offers custom fitted, custom altered bras in 2,500 size combinations specific to your body type, shape, size, anatomical features, and breast weight. Call Maria today to find out more at 360-815-3205.
Oh, couldn't help it. Got to have a Canada shout out.
Yeah. Welcome back. It's our neighbors to the north.
I know. We love you, Canada. That's Benny, our producer, always slaying it. We love you, Canada. We're here talking about the elections and cannabis policy reform with Justin Strekal from NORML. But before we get into Canada, Justin, we were just talking about, I just got a listener question as we were listening, and the question was, who would donate $1 million to an anti-cannabis campaign? And we were just kind of saying, someone who sucks. But you made a really good point during the break about kind of this idea of people contributing and what the contribution really means. And I'd love for you to share it again.
Absolutely. When we look at people who are our routine political donors, They're making these contributions because they know it's effective, and they have an agenda, and it is a way for them to move the ball forward to implement or maintain their agenda. And most supporters of cannabis reform are not big donors. We're not talking about people who have the ability to write $100,000 checks.
Sure.
But when enough people come together and chip in what they can, be it $5, be it $20, be it $100 to an effort, then collectively we're going to be able to build the kind of political infrastructure needed to take on these kind of big money opponents. Here at NORML, our average contribution is just $22. And, you know, we're not getting big money from the industry because there are some areas where we disagree with the industry, the marijuana industry on. You know, as we represent consumers' issues and criminal justice issues and civil justice issues. But, you need to get involved and chip in what you can when you can. And if you can't give your money, give your time.
Absolutely. And that doesn't mean your time fighting and arguing online, like turn up.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah, no, that doesn't help. No, make phone calls. Talk to people face-to-face, organize educational meetings. I mean, the barrier to entry into the democratic process is incredibly low. And it's more accessible than people realize.
Absolutely. Cool. Well, now on that note, let us congratulate our neighbors to the north for fully legalizing, or is it decriminalizing cannabis?
Legalizing, yeah.
Fully legalizing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yep.
That's awesome.
Prime Minister Trudeau is truly king in the north.
Truly.
And
he's our Jon Snow,
it's
baby.
Historic. Absolutely. And he you know, Canada has taken the bold leadership to become the second country in the Western Hemisphere that has legalized marijuana. And dispensaries are going to be opening their doors on October 17th.
So
we are just two weeks from the day of when dispensaries are opening in our neighbors to the north. So
amazing.
For those of you who are thinking about a vacation, you know, get your absentee ballots in, go vote early, and then
and then
take a nice trip up to Canada.
Perfect. Now, they don't mind us coming in there to engage in the new facilities, right? The Canada doesn't mind. People can be from anywhere. They don't have to just be a Canadian citizen to come up and go to the dispensaries.
Correct. Canada is a generous enough of a nation that they afford their liberties to their residents and visitors.
Absolutely, which is cool. Now, one of my questions about Canada, because we have the same issues in Colorado, people come here, they go to the dispensaries, but then they can't use the cannabis anywhere if they're smoking it. Does Canada have like an allotment for that? Like, are you allowed to use it in public there? Do you know about any of this?
No. Public consumption is not allowed, but there are going to be special use licenses for social consumption clubs. If, you know, not all those regulations are worked out yet, and that's all going to be done at the local level. So those will come in the months and years to come following the implementation of legalization. But they're going to implement it much, much faster than places like Colorado and Washington have when they still have it.
Yeah, we're still
struggling. It's on the way.
Denver voted for public use last year, but nothing's happened yet. So I don't know. I guess we'll see. But the other thing about Canada that we need to touch on in our last couple minutes is this new law or measure that was passed here in America banning Canadian citizens who are part of the cannabis industry from entering the U.S. What is going on with that?
So it's important we're specific in our terms here. So there is no law saying that explicitly that we need to prevent Canadians who are earnest, honest, overly polite.
I know, what a threat.
From coming, who work in the cannabis, in the legal Canadian cannabis industry, from entering the U.S. But the center or the Customs and Border Patrol, CBP, who have not been getting good press recently for this issue and a multitude of other things, they have decided to interpret a statute in such a way that they are choosing to prohibit the entry into the United States of those who are engaged in the legal Canadian cannabis commerce.
I also read it's any Canadian
no
who ever...
Interpret that.
Oh, sorry. What was that? I'm sorry to talk over you.
Oh, no. All they need to do is say that we misinterpreted it, and here's your visa.
Okay. Because, is this actually happening? Because I read that they were also trying to ban any Canadian who'd ever used cannabis from entering the United States, which sounds insane.
Yeah. It is insane. And, you know, we've had isolated incidents of individuals reporting that they were hampered by this. Most of them have been able to get through, not a problem, because there's a lot of Canadian businessmen and women who are coming down to the U.S. To learn best practices or find investors for their new Canadian enterprises.
Right?
You know,
is that what they don't want?
But we're also talking about an agency that under the current leadership of immigrations and customs and agencies, they're interpreting laws in a very, very dispassionate way, and in my view, a very cruel way. Yeah. And I think that cannabis is just yet another victim of the bad policy that's coming down from leadership.
And this is probably going to be resolved. Like, Canadians never fear, because I would like some Canadians to continue to come in here. I mean, they're our friends.
We're in crazy political times. We're talking about a trade war with Canada over maple syrup and timber. I mean, so I don't suspect that this is going to be a long-term problem. We've already built up a lot of congressional pressure to go after CBP. For their misinterpretation of an old statute. Yeah. So we're hoping to resolve it sooner than later, but given the kind of decisions that are being made by political appointees in the current administration and the cruelty of some of those interpretations and policies, I can't guarantee it's going to be rectified within the next 2.5 years.
Sure. But the best thing you can do, especially this November, is get out and vote, right?
Correct. Absolutely. And vote for pro-cannabis representatives and those who share other values that you share.
Yes. Well, on that note, that's all the time we have for today. But Justin Strekal of NORML, thank you so much for everything. Kelly, it was great to have you on. It's been awesome. And remember, guys, you can continue to follow up with NORML, just normal.org, for all of your cannabis policy reform resources and needs. And on that note, just turn up. Don't fight with people on the internet. Just turn up for your community and yourself. That's the way to do it, in my opinion. And remember, you can find all of our archive shows on lucidplanet.com. And I hope to have you guys tune in next time for more super lit family fun. Take care.
You've been listening to the hit show, Lucid Planet Radio, with renowned psychologist and author, Dr. Kelly Neff. Tune in as we illuminate your senses and empower you beyond your daily stressors and hardships. This hit show will captivate you with far-reaching topics and amazing guests as you wake up to the greatest version of yourself. Learn how to navigate the global shift of consciousness as you explore the deeper knowledge, passion, and purpose within. Visit lucidplanetradio.com for upcoming show topics and to contact Dr. Kelly.
The preceding audio was via a Skype call.